We're back. It's the weekly Noticias. Yes, we're back. They've allowed us out of the care home yet again for the final show of season one. Can you believe that? We've done 10 shows.
It's very exciting. Number 10. Who knew we get to double figures? Well done, us.
That was The Clash, Should I Stay or Should I Go? And of course, you have to stay. The Weekly Notices is live and uncut. We see it as a sort of language exchange show, helping you to prove your English and your Spanish and some of your Catalan each week by analysing the weekly news. And it's also a game show, but it's very hard to win points. Almost impossible, Susie. Okay? The rules are simple. There aren't any, apart from rules I make up as I go along. And along the way, we try and learn 7 new words, normally. On my right this week is... Well, I've got some fantastic people in the studio. Normally, I have Chris Groves, but this week I've got somebody with a same surname, but a different background, I believe.
No relation, yeah.
No relation at all.
Apparently.
He seems to have a couple of pseudonyms and identities, actually. And from what I understand, he was a top TV executive from London, a renowned scriptwriter. He is a renowned scriptwriter for kids TV. And then a visit to Barcelona changed your life. Is that correct?
It happens to a lot of people. You just come here for 5 minutes and then 10 years later, you're still here. So, happy to be here.
The man formerly known as Rupert, the TV executive in London. Please welcome Jon Groves.
Thank you very much. Good morning. And can I just say, it's a real honour to sit in Chris's chair this morning. I won't let you down, hopefully. I'll keep up your unblemished record.
Does that mean Chris is still in the care home?
Chris is still in the care home.
We don't know where he is, do we?
I should have mentioned earlier that I've got yes and no buttons as well, that sometimes to keep you all in control, but we'll use those later. Adding glamour to John's team this week is a journalist, I believe former actress, and I originally understand from Romania. You've been in Barcelona 17 years. She holds a degree in English philology, study of English and French, I believe you said.
Yeah, English and French philology.
From the University of Bucharest. She's the editor of the fantastic English language magazine Catalunya Today, based in Girona, and appears regularly on El Punt Avui TV, particularly the English Hour. Please welcome Marcela Topor. Fantastic to have you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
It's great to have you here. On my left, we're delighted to have somebody that was originally born in Wales.
So true.
Whereabouts in Wales? Glananum or something?
Glananum.
Yeah? And you've lived in Barcelona since when?
2001.
Yeah? And why did you come here originally?
The weather, the climate, the people.
The people. Fantastic. She worked with BA. I'm not going to say who BA are, because I think you said they were previously BOAC for 32 years. And with Coutts Bank. She speaks perfect French, Spanish, English, and you're learning Catalan. Please welcome Susie Duguid. And on Susie's team, because Susie is team captain, I believe, is David Sanmiguel. He is a painter from, born in Saragossa. Mm-hmm. You now live in Barcelona, in Girona. You're brought up in Girona.
Yes.
And you specialise particularly in cityscapes of Girona. That sounds fabulous. Yeah?
Well, that's what I've been doing lately, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, as I say, please welcome David Sanmiguel.
Thank you very much for having me.
We're going to have a few art questions, I'm sure.
We should say he's canvases, not walls.
Canvases and not
in terms
walls.
Of
oh, that's important.
Although apparently, if the price is right,
sorry. Right. We also have our third referee and our first and our original Swede in the studio. She's going to be doubling up, helping us pour kava. I believe she's already started doing that. And with the word wheel this week, is that correct?
Yes, I'll be managing the application. Yes,
managing the application of the word wheel. Please welcome Viveka Nilsson.
Thank you.
Yeah, as I say, you're going to hear occasionally words like this. I've got an assistant that says...
Yes!
And somebody else that says...
No!
Okay, if you get the questions wrong. We have a website, theweeklynoticias.com. You can also find us on Twitter, Facebook and Instagram. Our podcasts are up on Mixcloud, Soundcloud, iVoox, and there's also a YouTube channel. So there's no reason, no excuse to not see or hear us. We're going to go straight to round one. Which is the people in the round, and we have a noise problem as always. The first thing in the news is the Balearic Islands. Why are they in the news? Can anyone give me... Who's going to kick us off on that? John?
The Balearic Islands. Well, there's a couple of things that I've heard about this week. One is something to do with bullfighting.
Yeah.
Is this true?
Yeah,
go on. They're going to try bloodless bullfighting.
Is that possible?
Well, it sounds like a good idea, although I sort of think maybe they should try bullless bullfighting. Sounds even more humane. But
we're going to give you a point for that. They've approved bloodless bullfighting.
Well deserved, yes.
Yeah, well deserved. How many other regions have banned this? Do you know?
I really don't know. I think that those are the only ones who are banned.
Well, somewhere else where you're sitting now?
Barcelona.
Oh, really?
Exactly. Yes, sure. Good point for Marcella.
Well, that was a very easy one. It shouldn't count.
Well, you have to grab the points where you
can.
Barcelona banned bullfighting in 2010. And
in Marbella, are they not changing bullfighting into, like, they're changing the rings into shopping centres or something? Not
in Marbella?
Around that area, I think.
Yeah?
Something like that, yeah.
So in Marbella, there's still bullfights, are there not?
Yeah, but they're going to turn them into shopping centres instead, so it's less controversial.
Will they keep the bulls or will they be getting rid of the bulls?
This is not clear yet.
Okay. So the bulls will stay in the shopping centre?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And the bullfighters will perform the thing in the shopping centre.
So it may not be bloodless, but the bulls should be fine. That's what we're saying.
Exactly.
I think in the Balearic Islands, Susie, do you know anything about this? I mean, they've banned bloodless bullfighting, but was it a big thing over there anyway? Do you know? I mean, do you follow bullfighting at all?
No, not really.
No?
No. I know that they're planning to make it 10 minutes instead of 30 minutes.
10 minutes of bullfighting instead of 30 minutes. Yeah. So they're still going to actually have bullfights, but they're going to be bloodless, as you say. And I think that's a bit strange. I have to admit that many years ago, until I understood what I was actually watching, I did see lots of bullfights in Madrid. But I have to say, I think it repulses me now. So I think Balearic Islands is good. But they're also in the news for another reason. Why is that, John?
Something about getting rid of booze.
Yeah,
getting rid of booze in the Balearics.
Very good.
It'll be easier to get rid of blood in bullfighting than it is to actually get rid of booze in the Balearics with stag doos.
Yeah, they're not going to get rid of booze in the whole of the Balearics.
Ah, okay, I've misunderstood.
They're ban booze on the flights that go to the Balearics.
Right. There's been some bad behaviour on planes. A bit of people getting overexcited.
Stag nights to Ibiza and Mallorca have asked Spain and the European Union to ban alcohol on flights.
I think that's fine, though. I mean, you can still have 6 or 7 pints in the morning before you get on the plane, so I don't see that being particular...
a necessity.
Are they banning bad behaviour in the lavatories?
Do you normally have 6 or 7 pints before you get on a flight?
Everybody does. You have to. That's part of the holiday, isn't it?
Yeah.
And if you can get a nice breakfast flight going, get a bit of Guinness in. It's
great. Quite weird. I mean, did you have that when you were with BA?
Loads, absolutely loads, especially going to the Gulf in the like 70s, 80s. There was a whole back cabin of the aeroplane that would be solid drinkers.
Yeah, because when they got to the Gulf, they couldn't drink, perhaps.
Hmm?
When they got to the Gulf, they couldn't drink?
Yes, exactly.
So they were like making up for it on the flight.
Yeah, going completely crazy.
Excellent point.
You were saying there was a stag do at the back of the plane, they bought the whole drinks.
I was on a plane once back from, it's good actually, good job that Neil Stokes isn't with us again, because it was back from Liverpool. It was from Liverpool back to Barcelona, and there was like lots of Everton supporters, and you know, and they were basically two stag nights in the middle of the plane, and they bought the trolley. They basically bought the booze trolley. They bought everything on the booze trolley.
Well, at least they bought it.
They bought it. At least they bought it. Right, okay, also in the news. What about some trivia questions on the Balearic Islands? Ooh. Tell me about the Balearic Islands. There are 4 islands. Come on, what are the 4 islands? You've been to one of them recently, Viveka.
Yes, I thought the news story was Swedish-Spanglish radio producer goes AWOL, but that didn't make the headlines.
Right, what happened to you then? Did you go to...
Well, no, just a little bit of radio silence, I think. But
radio silence.
Nothing serious, no.
Yeah. We managed to survive without you here.
Yes, it's incredible. It's incredible. I don't know how you did.
A bit of radio science is our trademark, really.
I do know the 4 islands.
Okay, what are they? Come on.
Mallorca, Menorca, Ibiza, Formentera.
Okay, and what's the smallest?
Formentera.
Okay, and why? Everyone falls in love with Ibiza. Why? And what's the big thing about Ibiza?
It's magical.
It's magical, okay.
Yes. Apparently there's a vortex around it, like a Bermuda Triangle.
Really?
Yeah, something like that.
Okay.
This hasn't been proved, though.
Okay, all right, we're going to go on to the next... You got a bonus. Our third referee and original Swede has got a point. The 1992 Olympics and Freddie Mercury. Why are they both in the news? Come on, Susie, help us out on this one.
It's 25
because of
years.
The song.
No. The 1992
Barcelona.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And who did Freddie sing the song with?
Montserrat Caballé.
Exactly. Fantastic. And why is the 1992 Olympics in the news today or yesterday?
Yesterday.
Because it was today.
25 years since the Olympics in Barcelona.
Excellent point for Marcella. Excellent point. It was 25 years ago, and it was anyone here? Did you I was living here at the time.
Yeah,
I was here. It was my first time here, and it was a magical time to be here. I have to say, it was a really magical time. And they celebrated yesterday the 25th anniversary. The King of Spain was here in Barcelona. In fact, he was at the ceremony, the opening ceremony, when he was 24, carrying the Spanish flag. So it was 25 years ago, so it's quite apt that he was here. And they had a big ceremony to celebrate it, and it was... Were you not here, John, either?
No, I wasn't here, and it's stunning. 25 years, bad enough, but the fact that I remember watching Freddie Mercury at the Olympics singing that song, but apparently he didn't. He died before the Olympics,
and I
can't believe that.
Me too. I had exactly the same impression.
Did he die before the Olympics?
Yeah. A year before.
I know.
Yeah, you're both right, and you both getting the bonus point. It was actually a video of him with Montserrat Caballé, I don't know.
Caballé.
Yeah. And it was a magical video of them both singing Barcelona.
But they sang together live.
Yes, they did sing together live. But it
Plaza de España.
Just up by the fountains, wasn't
maybe,
it?
Yeah.
Maybe that was the video of it.
I think that was the show. That
but
was
because the,
video.
The song dates back to 87, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And... But I do remember, like you, John, I was in Romania watching TV, watching the Barcelona Olympic Games, and I remember clearly seeing Freddie Mercury and Montserrat Caballé.
Yeah.
And I just actually found out recently that he died a year before.
I know.
So it's
it was magic. It really, really was a magical time to be in Barcelona, and to get I admire Barcelona for getting Freddie Mercury to sing a song with Barcelona in the title. I always thought that was great branding at the time. I think it was a fabulous. He's also in the news, Freddie Mercury, which we're going to come to for the next. Is there a noise going on for you? Are you okay here?
No, we're fine.
The next item in the news is Sean Spicer. Now, we might link Freddie Mercury to Sean Spicer. First of all, who is Sean Spicer? Why is he in the news? Susie?
The US Press Secretary.
He was the US Press Secretary.
Was.
Yeah. Where's he gone?
He's resigned.
Right.
Because of the appointment of... Scaramouche.
Excellent point. Anthony Scaramucci.
Right. Yeah, not Scaramouche.
And what does Anthony Scaramouche have to do with Freddie Mercury?
Because it's a line from Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yes. And anyone know the lyrics of Bohemian Rhapsody? John?
I think Scaramucci, can you do the fandango?
Excellent point of John. Yes.
I mean, Sean Spicer.
I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me. And then it goes on. Yeah, carry on.
Well, nobody loves Sean Spicer, but I think it's harsh because he's been the most loyal kind of servant to Trump.
Do you think
ever.
So?
I mean, anybody who can stand up and keep spouting what he's been spouting and like he almost believes it, I think deserves a promotion.
Good point. Good point. Excellent. I mean, there were like six, I think there's five or six things that he came out with that were the most ridiculous comments, but it was backing up Trump all the time. For example, I don't know if you remember on the inauguration day, Trump said it was the biggest crowd ever for a president. And poor Spicer had to go up and say this was the largest audience to ever witness an inauguration period. And then they put up photos of Obama's inauguration and Trump's inauguration, and it just proved him wrong. And then he made comments about a Russian salad dressing. He tweeted that if the president put Russian salad dressing on his salad tonight, somehow that's a Russian connection. That was a classic from Sean Spicer. And his worst was the Hitler comparison. I don't know if you remember that. Does anyone know that one? And bonus points there.
Yeah, but it's painful to talk
tried
about.
To blank it out, I think, that one. Yeah. That's when it stopped getting funny, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was,
all right, it was, yes, about the chemical weapons.
Yeah, it was absolutely... And I think that was his... That was his low point. Anthony Scaramucci has come in as the communications director, and therefore Sean Spicer has been replaced. So what was Scaramucci's nickname, do you know?
The Mooch.
Excellent point. The Mooch.
I can't believe myself.
The Mooch. And where did he work before? Come on.
I think, is he Wall Street.
Wall Street, yes. Excellent. Specifically at Goldman Sachs.
And this is the kind of guy you want. He's worked in a bank, so he's had a life experience. Yeah. He's called the Mooch, which means he's obviously been some sort of frat house member, which is great. He looks very, you know, multicultural.
I'm sure
he's, you know, and I think he's great.
And his name sounds like a Freddie Mercury song.
Scaramucci. Sean Spicer.
And he can do the Fandango.
And there's this obsession with facts and experts, and I think he's just going to carry on. You know, we're moving on. Life moves on, and I think you don't need facts, really.
So you don't feel sorry for Sean Spicer?
It'd be interesting to see what happens to him. But I think he's got a unique skill set, and I think perhaps he'll be on The Apprentice or something like that.
Another point for John, because actually it feels like the whole Apprentice thing with Trump changing everyone, saying you're fired and all this. I think Trump's treating it as a bit of a game. Next on the news, the BBC. What does the BBC stand for, David? Do you know?
British Broadcasting Company?
Corporation. Excellent.
Corporation.
Excellent. Why are they in the news? You probably don't care about the BBC here, but it's quite big news in the UK.
I watch quite a lot of it.
Yeah?
That means a big Only Fools and Horses fan.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, you know, but that's a classic. The thing is, Susie, come on, tell me what BBC...
It's about equal pay.
Equal pay. And why is that an issue with the BBC?
All the women are being paid way less than the men for doing the same kind of job.
All right, yeah.
Presenters are being paid considerably less.
Exactly.
So what they're going to do is instead of giving women the same amount of money as men, they're going to bring the men down to match the women, which seems like...
Was the job worth it or not?
Who knows? It's very strange.
There are 42 top female broadcasters at the BBC who are demanding to tackle the gender pay gap rather than wait until 2020. They're claiming there's a sex discrimination. Is there a gender pay gap in Spain? Marcela, do you think that happens here as well?
Well, I think so, unfortunately.
Across everywhere, yeah?
Yeah. But it's... I think it's starting to change, but it's not as fast as it should.
No.
But let's be optimistic about it.
Well, we're leading the way a bit, aren't we? I mean, we all get paid the same for the Weekly Noticias. Which is great. So.
John. You do not get an extra point for that,
makes
John.
Makes the tax return easy, anyway.
You do not get a point for that, I'm sorry.
I had to buy the... What? Sorry.
The reason I asked about BBC and what it stands for is because, you know, you mentioned to me earlier about BAU being BOAC. And then there's that BA... I want to talk about British Airways for a very quick minute. And it's not on the agenda, but British Airways... Airways. You're a specialist on ABBA.
Yes, I am. Yeah.
And if you want, you could name the four people of ABBA if I asked you to quite easily.
But I could also tell you that it's a Swedish herring brand.
ABBA is a Swedish herring brand.
Yes, not to be confused with a world famous band.
Right.
Would you like to know the members?
Yeah, why not?
Yeah. Agneta Fältskog, Anne-Frid Lyngstad, Björn Ulvaeus and Benny Andersson.
Excellent. Oh, nice. I just love her saying that for some reason. But there's also, in the UK, they, and in fact globally, they say ABBA. For what does it sound for?
Anything but British Airways.
Anything but British Airways, because British Airways have a really bad reputation at the moment because of lots of things going on.
Right.
And so ABBA also means anything but British Airways, which I think is quite funny. Okay, next.
There's another thing. Sorry, just to jump in there. I thought this was going to be about ABBA because of the whole controversy with the recent Spain-England ladies football.
No, what happened
they were
there?
Talking about...
You're looking for an extra point, aren't you?
I am, indeed. At least one. Because they're saying instead of doing penalty shootouts like A-B-A-B, teammate, they're going to do A-B-B-A to make it easier.
What's
which hopefully
mean?
Will help us with the...
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about penalty shootouts, the end of football games.
Well,
we've lost to Germany every time since, like, 400 years ago.
Yeah,
and if they make it A-B-B-A, so somebody takes one, and then you take two, and then they take one, it makes it better.
Right. Well, John, do we give John a point?
Yes, of course.
I'm sorry. Okay, next in the news, Christopher Nolan... Anyone know about Christopher Nolan? Have you heard about Christopher Nolan?
Well, he's a film director. Dunkerque.
I would say Dunkirk. You've just pronounced it fantastically. Dunkerque.
Yeah, well, I don't know why I pronounced it that way.
No, that's probably... that's fine. How would you pronounce Dunkirk?
Dunkirk.
Yeah. How would you pronounce it in Sweden?
Dunkirk. We don't have our own version of that.
Yeah, well, he's done this film and apparently it's superb. The film is superb. Have you seen it?
No, not yet.
No? Have you seen it, John?
Not yet. It's on my list.
No, me neither, but it's on my list.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be a fantastic, fantastic film. It's got, what's his name, Kenneth Branagh in it and all the old lovers.
And Thingy out of the boy band, hasn't it? It's his first acting. Who's the guy?
Styles.
Yeah, Nobby Styles.
Harry Styles.
Harry Styles.
Harry Styles is in Dunkirk.
Yeah, yeah. This is his first acting. I think he's going to be quite good. I don't know whether he gets, you know, blown away early doors, but...
Let's hope so. apparently, we shouldn't have said that about Harry Styles.
No, he's really good.
A bit of trivia here. When was Christopher Nolan born? Nobody knows?
69.
No, 1970. No? He's a British-American film director, screenwriter and producer. He is one of the highest grossing directors in history, which means his movies have grossed more money than... many other
but not as much as his sisters.
Exactly.
His sisters had a very famous band, didn't they? And apparently they've done even
the Nolans.
That so I hear. Is that not true?
Another Chris in the news. Christopher Clive Froome. What's he been doing?
Winning his fourth Tour de France.
He had a bit of a cycle race, yeah? Tour de France. Do you like cycling? Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I used to.
Yeah? Where did you cycle?
No, I used to watch it on television in the summer, especially when they went up the mountains, very, very high climbing.
Yeah.
On a hot summer day.
Yeah.
Watching telly with a beer in your hand. That was fantastic.
Yeah. It's lovely footage. The helicopter footage is amazing. It's a great advert.
It's a great show. It's a great show. Yeah.
It's very good.
I'm from the time of Indurain. Do you know Indurain in Spain?
Yeah. Miguel Indurain. He was from the Basque country, wasn't he?
He was from Navarra.
Navarra,
which is next to the Basque country.
Right.
He won 5 tours on a row.
Yeah. He was amazing.
Yeah, he was.
So has anyone broken... I'm not a great cyclist fanatic, so I don't know if any... As Miguel Indurain, does he still have the world record?
Well,
was a guy after him?
You know, the American guy who...
Oh, the guy that was being doped.
Allegedly. Oh,
allegedly. Yeah.
Well, not allegedly. Yeah, yeah. Oh, of course. We can now say that they pretty much all were.
So. Lance Armstrong, who used to live in Girona.
I was sort of starting afresh.
Yes. Lance lived in Girona.
Yeah, Girona is a big centre of...
Well, actually, Girona is now like a... kind of a mecca for
cyclists. Yeah.
And this is thanks to him, because he's the he was among the first ones, like the most famous one who actually chose Girona as his like base.
Right.
And he actually bought a flat in the middle of the old quarter in Girona, the Jewish quarter.
Right.
And he lived in Girona for a few years.
Right.
There was the time when he was married to the singer, to the
Sheryl Crow.
Exactly. Yeah.
So this is Lance Armstrong, used to live in Girona.
Yeah, yeah. Walking and shopping together on La Rambla.
Going to the chemist.
Oh, really?
You don't think that's where Lance Armstrong? You don't think that's where Lance Armstrong got his drugs in Girona?
Yeah, the chemist around the corner.
No, but yes, he came. Then lots of cyclists came along as well.
David Miller, exactly. Yeah,
and
because
many
he famously admitted doping and has changed it quite a lot. He's gone the other way to Lance. So
well done. Well, I think you, Chris. I'm sorry, it's John, isn't it?
That's
I think your team are winning a lot of points for the cycling. Yeah,
I think we are.
You're winning a lot of points
for everything.
Christopher Clive Froome. He actually has an OBE. He is a British road racing cyclist, and he's won the Tour de France, you're quite right, 4 times, 2013, 15, 16 and 17, so that's another Chris in the news this week.
Does anybody know the fastest recorded time on the Tour de France?
No.
No.
Not time, fastest speed, 81 miles an hour. That is 130 kilometres per hour.
No!
Coming down a hill on a bike.
We're not going to give him any more points
for
this.
No, but that is impressive, isn't it?
Fast.
Okay, next in the room, quick roundup of the other people in the news. Two people. Beyoncé.
Twins. And photographs with her new twins.
No.
Madame Tussaud.
Madame Tussaud, excellent point. Excellent point. And why is she in the news about Madame Tussaud?
Because they have made a wax model out of her.
Yeah.
Apparently it actually looked like her. It's the first one they've ever done.
No, come on. What have they done?
It's not the right colour.
Yeah, they had whitewashed Beyoncé.
And also, she looks different.
Yeah.
Apparently, some visitors complained or expressed their opinion on Twitter, saying that she looks much more like Britney Spears,
excellent, yeah.
Another singer.
They probably used the Britney Spears base, because they'd taken Britney Spears away, and then they thought, we can make a Beyoncé out of this, I reckon.
The news is the museum had whitewashed Beyoncé. Its wax makers had made the 35-year-old singer lighter skinned, and after a lot of anger on social media, as you say, they took the statue away and adjusted the styling and lighting of her figure to make her look more realistic. Can you believe it?
Mm.
So she's in the news, and also LinkedIn, or was it, what are they called?
In Spanish, it's called LinkedIn.
Yeah, no, I'm actually talking about Linkin Park.
Oh, right.
Right, Linkin Park. Susie, Linkin Park.
No idea.
You've got no idea?
No idea.
No, nor did I. No, I had no idea either. I'm sorry, because my music tastes are quite odd. Linkin Park, I googled Linkin Park, and it came up, and it said not to be confused with Linkin Park, which is actually a square in New York. And Linkin Park, it's sad news, actually, because one of the members of Linkin Park, Chester Bennington, died, and so that's in the news. But anyone a fan of Linkin Park?
Yeah, they did some good stuff. I couldn't name it, but it's quite a heavy kind of... I'm surprised, how old was he?
I don't know. Very it's young, a sad I story. I think it's also...
Mid-30s, terrible. That's the second one to go, isn't it?
But I think they were in the news. And Linkin Park, there was a newsreader. It's in the news because there was a newsreader that said, and it's very sad, Chester Bennington from LinkedIn... They actually said it on the news.
I would think he wasn't on LinkedIn.
Well, anyway, that's the news. So, at the end of round one, which is always the long round, what is the score?
Well, it's great, actually. Great news for Chris's stand-in team. They're doing really well because it's 2-4-6. It's 9 to John and Marcella, and it's Susie and David back on 5.
Well, back on 5. Right, okay. And what does a word wheel throw up?
Right, let's have a little look at that.
Yeah.
The fandango.
Right. What does the fandango mean?
I think it's a Spanish dance performed with castanets.
Performed with castanets. So Anthony Scaramucci can do the fandango. let's assume he can. Okay. Round two. This is the answer. And you have to guess the question. The answer is 10 past 10. Okay.
I know this one.
Well, you're not going to say anything for a while. We're going to hand it over to you. David.
Yes, the question is, at what time were you meant to be here?
I asked you to get any time after 10. And so 10 past 10. That's not the right answer. I'm sorry. No.
Oh.
Susie, what's the right answer? 10 past 10. Come on.
10 past 10.
Something to do with painting. Something to do with an artist.
Okay. The points on Salvatore Dali's moustache.
Exactly.
Hey.
Very, very good.
Gosh. Hey.
Salvatore Dali, they had to exhume his body last week.
Yeah.
And the embalmer... it's a really sort of got weird story, but they say that his moustache is intact at the 10 to 10.
Do you think it kept growing after? They say it keeps growing. They do say that, don't they? Fingernails, hair,
a point,
and
a point away from
John. Moustaches.
A point away.
Right.
But being accurate.
I'll deal with that.
It's a good story, though, isn't it? Don't you think?
Yeah, it's a very good story. Actually,
it's
so Dali.
Completely surrealistic story.
Yeah, exactly.
I think Dali would have loved it.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's what they were all saying. Dali would have loved the story of him being, I don't like the word dug up, but being resurrected.
Yeah, it's a surrealist.
He'd go for a resurrection.
Act. It's like a surrealistic performance.
It is.
Like
it is quite. It's
conceived
quite
by Dali or something.
Yeah, and the reason he's being exhumed, as we've already spoken on this show before, is because they're trying to get DNA samples to see if Maria Pilar Abel is his daughter.
Mm.
So anyway, his moustache was intact, and that is it was at 10 past 10.
Did you know that Dali is actually a classification in the world moustache growing competition in Germany every year? It's a category.
No.
And the other categories are natural, English, imperial, Hungarian, freestyle, and Frida Kahlo.
No!
Oh, God.
The Dali is slender with long tips, straight up or arching up. 10 to 10.
No!
I still know.
Okay, word from round two. What does the word wheel throw up first?
The word from round two is embalmer.
Embalmer. And what's the score after round two?
I took a hit there, but it's now 9-7.
Okay, so you have two words. You have the fandango, which comes from Anthony Scaramucci. Okay. And you also have embalmer, which comes from Dali's moustache. And David, the reason we do these words, mm-hmm. is, I mean, your English sounds absolutely perfect, but we normally have on this show Xavi Castells, who we try to improve his English each week. but do you use those words in Spanish?
Embalmer all the time.
You do? You use that?
as a matter of fact, I use it with no reason, really. Just for the...
And what is embalmer in Spanish?
Embalsamador.
Okay, well, there you go. There you go. Excellent point for David.
Oh, well, sir.
And in Catalan, what would it be?
Embalsamador.
That sounds like Barcelona, Barça. That sounds like a football
match. It sounds like a football team,
So Embarma, from English to Catalan, almost sounds like Barça.
Yeah.
Okay, well, that's a good point.
Yeah,
okay.
Thank you.
Okay, right, round three. This is the missing words headline. And Trump, the Spanish missing word quotation is Trump puedo. It's Trump saying that he can do something, which is Trump. And he then says, puedo, blank. What does he say?
Can I come in on this one?
Yeah, you can say something, go on.
I think, using my Spanish skills, it's Trump puedo. Because that must mean Trump says, I can.
Okay, we'll give him a half a point. Susie, do you read Spanish newspapers, come on. But you probably read this in English about Trump.
I don't remember anything about this at all.
Okay,
Tim.
Marcela, do you know anything about Trump saying puerto something?
I'm sorry, I can't think of anything.
Okay, I'm going to tell you, because
you can't really do anything.
None of you have done your homework.
You can't do
anything. It's on the front page of the La Vanguardia the other day. It says, Trump puro perdonar.
Oh, yes.
Oh, of course,
Because he's basically created a law, or the law already exists, where he can pardon himself. Mm-hmm. So he can do anything he wants. and then say, no. The American Constitution says,
I think the Catholic Church should take some notice from that.
Yes.
It would be a new technique to gain followers.
Excellent point.
You don't need to go to the confessionary.
You can just say Trump says you can
follow this instruction.
Very good point from David.
I think so.
Okay, and the other, so this is also linked to Trump, actually. His son-in-law came out with a quote, which is, I did not blank. What is the word with Russians? What did his son-in-law not do with Russians, Susie?
Meet with.
No, I can't give you a point for that, Susie.
Have relations.
It's nearly there. What did you say?
Have relations.
Didn't have relations.
And they can't give you a point, Marcela?
I don't know.
Okay, we'll give you half a point for that. It's not that either. What's Trump's son-in-law's name?
Snog.
It's not Snog.
It's the mooch.
Oh, no, that's the mooch. Nah, very good point. Very good point. But that's not, I did not snog with Russians. No, he didn't say that. President Trump's son-in-law, whose name is Jared Kushner.
The Kush.
So we got Mooch and Kush. He actually came out and he said, he had to give us, God knows why, but he's come out with this big press release and statement saying that I did not collude with Russians.
Collude.
Do you know what collude means, David?
No.
Okay. Have relations.
I did not collude with it.
All right. You see, I wasn't so far removed from the fact.
No, it's true.
No.
The nature of the collusion, we're not sure about.
He said, all my actions were proper and occurred in the normal course of events of a very unique campaign. It's a bit like, what's his name? Bill Clinton saying, I did not have collusions with that,
Right. Yes.
Okay. All right. So, at the end of round three, what's the score?
John and Marcella still in the lead with 10, and the other team 9.5.
And what's the word we'll throw up, Viveka?
Pardon.
Okay. So you got the Fandango from Antonio Scaramucci, the Embarma, which is like Barça in Catalan, and pardon. Okay. Which is Trump saying he can pardon himself. So you've got three words there. We're going to have one more quick round before we have the halftime. And it's the baddie round. So normally in this round, we have people giving me bad stories. David, has anyone done bad things to you this week or anything bad in the news?
Yes, I think so. There's always one every week. The baddie of the week. I had something to prepare for the good thing of the week. may I start with that one?
He's got to lose a point for that. He can't pretend.
No, I cannot lose.
He can't pretend to have a baddie of the week.
Right. David, we can't have you jumping the questions.
That's not good. That's got to hurt.
Okay.
A couple of points off.
Susie, who's your baddie?
Xi Jinping.
Is that how you pronounce Xi Jinping?
I've got no idea, but I thought it sounded
a
bit right.
That's a very good pronunciation. Xi Jinping. What's he done wrong?
He's the Chinese president, and he's disappeared the wife of the Nobel laureate.
Really? Allegedly.
Allegedly. But she has disappeared after the death of her husband, who is the Nobel laureate.
Well, Xi Jinping was in the news last week because of Winnie the Pooh. He'd banned Winnie the Pooh, and now he's made somebody else disappear. Allegedly. Okay, we're going to give you a point for that.
Allegedly.
Marcela, any bad news stories? Anything bad happened?
Not to me in particular, but yeah.
In the news.
Thanks, God. But yeah, in the news, I was just reading about something that happens almost every summer. Mm. I mean, the queues at the airports.
Yeah, you're right. God, and, it's happening again, isn't it?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. So apparently, Barcelona Airport is very crowded, immense queues, and it's collapsed, and it's not even August, so
it's going to get worse. And why is that? Is it a strike that's going on, or is it was passport control before, wasn't it?
Yeah, apparently, yeah. In August, they tend to have strikes.
Right.
Yeah. It's the best time of the year, right?
Typical.
So yeah.
Okay, we're going to give you a point for that. Barcelona Airport is bad news at the moment. And John, anything from you? Any bad
stories?
Yeah,
I really have. I got caught up in the queue barges myself, and that was going to be my
at
thing.
At the airport?
But, yeah, I did. Yeah. It was a nightmare. But then I discovered Pyrenean shepherds this week. They're accusing a bear called Goyat of chasing a flock of 209 sheep off a cliff to their
death.
That's
terrible.
Has anybody else heard this?
Yeah, it's terrible.
Unbelievable. I mean, it's a grisly story about some woolly jumpers, if you will. But
a bear pushing sheep off a cliff.
So this is no bad jokes here. Basically, there's 35 bears in the Pyrenees, and he's been accused of a crime he didn't commit. His tracking device shows that he wasn't even in the area.
A bear in the Pyrenees.
So somebody's done it, and it's basically an opportunity for the shepherds to gang up on the bears and say they're killing our flocks, chasing off the. Off cliffs, and it's not good enough.
Good job, it's not winning the poo, because that's a bear, isn't it, Susie?
He doesn't want to go to the Pyrenees, because if he's caught in a field with some sheep,
we're going to give John a point for all those bear stories. Apparently, there's a grizzly bear pushing sheep off cliffs.
No, he's not, though. He's not. He's being accused of it.
He's not a bear. He's being accused of it. Okay,
he's innocent.
All right. Well, we're going to give you a point.
He's being fleeced.
Okay, we're going to give you a point. We're not going to keep giving you points if you repeat the story, though. But we're going to give you a point for that. So well done. My baddie of the week is a poor guy in Seville who's been waiting 14 years to have his car fixed. Can you believe that? There's a poor chap, his name's Jose Cortes, and he said he's been living a nightmare for the past 14 years because the initial estimates for the cost of fixing his car were around $10,000, and he paid them an advance of $2,500, and then they just disappeared, and he's still waiting after 14 years to see if he can get his car fix. So I just think it's a Ford Sierra.
And I think that sounds more like a Fiat Fiasco.
Just pulled in a fantastic point for you. Okay, end of round four. What's the word? Throw up, Viveka.
Oh, it's nightmare.
Yeah, you see, it's from the poor chap from Seville who's living a nightmare. So we have four words: Fadango from Scaramucci, Embalmer from the Barca football, pardon and nightmare. And what is the score?
John and Marcella are on 11, but Susie and David have made a comeback. They're on 11.5.
Amazing. Well, I hope you're all enjoying yourselves. That's the end of the first round. We're going to take a break. I think there might be a Carver question immediately afterwards. That's what we normally have.
There'll be another bottle of wine.
There'll be another bottle, because it's our last show from this season one. And we're going to go out. We're going to have some music now for halftime. We'll be back in a short while.
Myself alone when each day is through. Yes, I'll admit that I'm a fool for you, because you're mine, I walk the line. As sure as night is dark and day is light, I keep you on my mind both day and night. And happiness I've known proves that it's right, because you're mine, I walk the line. Mm-hmm. You give me cause for love that I can't hide. For you I know I'd even try to turn the tide. Because you're mine, I walk the line. Close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine.
Okay, we're back. That was Johnny Cash, I Walked the Line. And quick roundup again of the score coming into the second half. What is it?
Susie and David in the lead with 11.5. Jon and Marcela hanging on well on 11.
Okay, you're listening to the Weekly Noticias with myself, Tim Parfitt, and my guests, Jon, Marcela, Susie, and David. And we now go to the second half, and it's round 5. Well done, Viveka. You got that right. And it's the good news story of the week, okay? And during the halftime break, you had a little refreshment of Carver, Susie, so you should be happy to tell us a good story. Come on.
I read something lovely in the newspaper yesterday about a guy called Verdun Hayes who has won he's brought back a record to England, which is a Guinness World Book of Records. At the age of 101 and 38 days, he's skydived.
Fantastic. That's his age.
That's his age.
That is amazing.
He skydived.
Wow. Skydived at 101.
To be fair, though, anybody can skydive. It's the landing is the secret, isn't it?
We're not going to let John take your point away from you, Susie. And the poor guy who's 101, you wouldn't say to him, yeah, that anyone can do that. But, you know, I mean, he landed.
I apologise.
Well, he did land.
He's still alive. Yeah,
right. Well,
still
I think
okay,
that's
yeah.
fantastic.
Okay. Wasn't a sad story.
David, any good news stories?
Yes, I have a good news.
You had a good news story when we had the bad news.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, yeah. You know,
you've remembered it now?
Yep. London Bar in Barcelona has reopened.
The London Bar?
London Bar. I don't know if you know about the London Bar. Yeah.
Is it good?
It's in Nou de la Rambla next to Palau Güell.
Yeah. Sounds
so,
good.
So, yeah, it's great. It's one of the very, very few modernista bars remaining in Barcelona.
Right.
And apparently it was... I thought it never closed, but it did a few months ago when the last owner just... died, but now someone else has bought the place and opened again. So I recommend to go there. It's a great place. It's a
excellent
great
point. Yeah.
Bar.
Yeah. And is it a special? Why is it called London Bar? Is it because they serve gin or London gin or?
I don't know. Because in those days, any bar just going off the standards would take a foreign name, and they has nothing like a pub or anything like that. Nothing. English about it.
It's there's also
Barcelona Modernista, but
Bar Marsella, no?
Which is Bar Marsella is another of those. Again, Marsella, like nothing on this side of the world, Marsella, London, something like that, just because they were a bit strange, a bit special.
Well, that's great. I should go to more of these bars, I think.
It's great. And apart from that, this has a very, very good, very good a tradition of, you know, artists, Picasso going there, poets, and blah, blah, blah. People.
And now I was there like 10 years ago, I think.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And
in the bar.
I remember, London Bar. And I remember it was a quite famous venue for live concerts.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. Indeed. Yeah.
Mm. Great. Yep. So it's got a modernista history to it, and it's
and not only the decoration and the sign is the original sign outside.
So it's like a bit like the what do you call it, the four cats, the bar they like. I can't pronounce
Quatre
it.
Gats.
Quatre Gats.
So it's that style of place. That, yeah.
Well, it's more. I would say Quatre Gats is a bit more touristic.
Yeah.
London Bar has never been a place for tourists. Really, tourists don't know about it because it's not publicized.
Well, John and I will make it touristic.
It's a bit misleading, though, isn't it? London Bar. It should be sticky floors and fights.
Exactly. Have you got any good news stories, Marcela?
Well, there are a few. I could pick up one. For example, I could congratulate you because I saw a tweet of yours today.
Yes.
Concerning your involvement in... a website.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Or a digital newspaper.
That's kind of
interesting. And they've just opened their English edition, right? Yeah. And I think that's really good news.
That's great. That's kind of amazing. Yeah, I'm going to give you 2 points for that. El Nacional punto cat, el nacional.cat, which is a brilliant online newspaper here, and published in Catalan and in Spanish, and they're now doing an English summary, English version of it, which is great.
Yeah, which is really great news, I think. I mean, Catania Today was among the among the first publications here in Catania. The Catalan publication in English, and now more and more publications are joining in.
Yeah.
And I think that's essential.
Yeah, and so, I think you do. With El Punt Avui as well, you have Catalunya Today, you have El Punt Avui English Hour, which you take part in, I know, and you also do a summary of the news on El Punt Avui at the back. And I think there's more and more interest in English news here. And I think it's great what you're doing there as well.
Forgetting the weekly Noticias.
And not forgetting the weekly Noticias, exactly. So there is more and more need and demand for English English news and English reporting here, which is great. And the Catalunya Today is a fantastic magazine. It's a fantastic magazine. So we're going to give you extra points for that. John, any good news?
Yes, Selina Juhl, I can't pronounce that properly, but she's a Danish... Oh, she's originally from Russia. She moved to Denmark, didn't like the sound of the whole food waste, and has reduced food waste in Denmark by 25% in 5 years.
Wow.
So stop wasting food.
She's been pushing sheep off cliffs.
Not that I'm aware of.
No, okay, well, we're going to give you a point for that. Okay, very quickly, my good news story is the good bit says, I don't know if this is true because they always keep talking about it, goodbye long lunches. Catalonia is moving to shorter working days. I don't know if that's actually really going to happen, but I wish it would. I once lived in Madrid for 10 years. I've been living here for 10 years, but I can still, I don't know about you, Susie, I still cannot get over the long lunch period, which is never... been like that in the UK. I mean, it's nice if you're going to a lunch and you're there and you know, it's fantastic. But when you've got work to do, I mean, it's sometimes it can be a bit frustrating. And especially here with estate agents, for example. If you wanted to go and try and view a property at lunchtime and the estate agent says, it's my lunchtime. You know? I mean, in England, that just... So
and
all
then
I
they
want
come
to,
back at 5,
exactly,
right?
Come back at 5.
So you're like...
And there's this big debate going on. I mean, there's a big debate going on about whether it will happen or not. And it's all because, there was a quote here which I love. It's because of the, I don't know if I'm going to pronounce this right, circadian rhythms. Do you know what circadian rhythms are of the body? It's basically the body clock.
Right.
Okay. So the circadian rhythm is a cycle that tells our bodies when to sleep, rise, eat, regulating many physiological processes. Okay. And the internal body clock is affected by environment, sunlight, temperature. Anyway, they're going to say it's not easy to change this because if you're born into a way of your body clock, but they're going to try and change it, which I think is good news. Okay, do I get a point for that?
Yep, give me a point.
Okay, yep, totally.
All right, then after that round, what is the word, Viveka?
It looks like the word is body clock.
Oh, what a coincidence.
Yes.
And what's the score?
14 to John and Marcella, 12.5 to Susie and David. This could be it, Chris. This could be our week.
It could be. You've got the Fandango, Embalmer, Pardon, Nightmare and Body Clock. We're going to go to round 6. We're going to have to go quite quickly onto round 6. It's the proverb, English proverb. We normally have an English proverb round. Sometimes we have a Swedish proverb. Sometimes we have a Catalan The proverb is scraping the bottom of the barrel. Do you understand what that means, David?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
What does it mean?
It means that making the most of what is left of really...
I don't know, actually, if that is totally correct. Susie? No?
I would say that it's the remnants, the dregs, and it's not the best.
So. Yeah, it's not the best. It's basically you're scraping, like, the worst of what's left.
Yeah, all right. Yes.
I will give you half a point for that. Yeah.
Is
there an equivalent in Catalan?
I think my idea, my proposal of a translation would be aprofitar las escurrialles, or fins les escurrialles are the drippings of
so making
of
the
whatever.
Best of the last dripping.
Making the best of the
Could Tim
the
just
really
pronounce that word for us just to make sure we get it? Could you just repeat that for him?
Escurrialles.
Escurriales.
Escurriales, yes. Escurriales are the really just...
Sounds like a ski resort.
Leftovers, the worst of the leftovers.
Sounds like a skin disease.
Escurriales, so it's like basically the drip, the drinks.
Exactly. Those things that, they are just... no one would use
No one
for
would
anything.
Normally have those.
Yeah.
Okay.
Apparently this phrase comes from that bloke who went off the Niagara Falls in the band.
That was the It's derived, actually, John, from the historical practice in the United States of storing food in barrels. When food supplies ran low, only what was on the very bottom of the barrel remained and had to be removed by scraping. So that's what it was. I don't know who chose these proverbs that are thrown at me each week. I'm not sure if it is the most elegant of proverbs, but there you go. Okay, after round six, what does that give us? What word?
Scraping.
Okay, and we've got two rounds left. We've got about 10 minutes to go. We're going to go quite quickly on these. What's the score, first of all?
It's 12.5-14.
Okay.
Still.
We got the Fandango, Embalmer, Pardon, Nightmare, Body Clock, and Scraping. I don't know how you're going to be able to make a sentence out of those. It brings us to round seven on this day in history. I like this round because it's the 26th of July and we always try and work out what happened in history. Two dates, 1953. What happened in 1953?
Battle of Pinchincha.
No, it was not. No, and that's an in-joke of the Weekly Noticias because there was a battle in Pichincha. Does anyone know? Marcella, do you know what happened in 1953?
Something related to Cuba.
Excellent. Very good. Right. Do you want to enlarge on that, Susie, for another point?
It was the start of the Cuban Revolution.
Excellent.
Yes. Like the July week.
Exactly. It was Fidel Castro's 26th of July movement, known as the Cuban Revolution. Very good. I'm impressed.
He had his 26th of July movement and then he started the revolution.
Yes.
It was also the first Cuban pirate radio broadcast, so it's quite a good example of, you know, combined PR.
Okay.
So he didn't just do the revolution, he actually told everybody about it. So.
Okay, talking of Fidel Castro, can anyone give a bit of trivia on him? Can anyone give me his full name? No?
No.
Fidel Alejandro Castro Ruth. Ruth. Okay. Ruth. When was he born? Does anyone know?
23.
No. He was born on August 13th, 1926, and died in November 2016. Okay, we don't want any more sad news about Cuba and the revolution. Okay, another year. 26th of July. This is a great one. 26th of July, 1943. Who was born?
Mick Jagger.
Excellent.
Oh, my God.
That's a very, very good point. Mick Jagger. And how old does that make him today?
175.
I think it's 74. And I think we should all say happy birthday to Mick. Now, I think he's my hero.
Yeah, I'm at 74. Yeah.
I think he's amazing. I think that is amazing. You know, you can talk about LinkedIn or whoever they were, but Mick Jagger, I mean, you know?
Yep.
He can skydive at 101.
Yep.
Mm. Yeah.
And land.
Yeah. I'm quite obsessed actually with his fitness regime and everything. You know. You know what he does, actually, psychologically. I hope I'm not boring any of you. You're all looking.
Not at all. That's very interesting.
No, it's fine.
He actually mentally changes his age. He's always done it. He's always imagined it. Psychologically, he's imagined himself as being 15 years younger than he actually is.
We all do that though, don't we?
It doesn't work.
The difficult thing is to do the other way around.
Mind over matter.
But I think the difficult thing is to be constantly aware of your real age. Mm. Normally, you know, you always think that you're younger than you are.
Yeah, okay. And that's what he does. So when he was like 40, he said, "No, I'm 25."
Okay.
And that's how he manages his whole body.
Yeah,
and
he's doing it on purpose.
Exactly, he does it on purpose. Now, I try that as well, but it just doesn't work.
It's not working.
It's not working for me.
I try it more than you do.
You try it as well, yeah?
And he gathers no moss.
Okay, after that round, therefore, I mean, he was very famous for some great songs, and so what does the word wheel throw up, Viveka?
It's quite intuitive, our word wheel, but it throws up the satisfaction.
Satisfaction. Okay, brilliant word. So, okay, after round seven, you have the Fandango, you have Embalmer, you have Pardon, Nightmare, Body Clock, Scraping, and Satisfaction. Can anyone make the best sentence from those seven words? Okay, David, over to you first.
Oh, my God, I just have half a sentence.
But it's for a big point this, you know.
Because
we're going to go into the final round, so what is it? Yeah. What's your sentence?
It's a nightmare to scrape an embalmer with no satisfaction or Fandango dancing involved when your body clock just is giving up.
Brilliant. That's 1 point to David. Okay, Susie.
So happy.
So have you come up?
No,
yeah.
Completely, you have not come up with this.
Okay, well, luckily your team's got a good point there.
All right.
Marcella, did you come up with any sentence on those seven words?
Well, I'm not very inspired at the moment.
No, not
I'm trying. I can try later.
Okay,
I'm
John, do you want to try and bail out your team here?
Well, I just had a little look, and let's see what I can come up with on the spot.
Okay.
My body clock's a nightmare. My head feels like a mango. So I tried to give my days a boost by dancing the fandango.
Oh!
Some scraping and some scratching will sometimes make me calmer, but my face still looks like an advert for a cheap Backstreet embalmer. So I have to beg your pardon if you get a bad reaction. But like Mick Jagger said,
I can't get no satisfaction. Fantastic.
I have to say,
brilliant.
No.
On the spot.
You get like several points for not only getting all of them into one sentence, but making a poem out of it. It's just absolutely brilliant. Okay, that takes us to the final round. Before the final round, which is the quick buzzers, you have to put this in the middle. What's the score, please?
John and Marcella have 27 after that bonanza, but Susie and David are still in it on 25.
Okay, right. Now, listen, this is the final round, and that's the noise, okay? It's fingers on buzzers. You have to put that in the middle. And can I just mention
that this round is sponsored by the Bodega Somos from Huesca, which we're now drinking, which is fantastic.
Well, congratulations to them.
Great.
They're lucky to be sponsoring a wonderful round, and that's very kind of them. And the final round is fingers on buzzers, and apparently all answers this week end in O or double O, or in other words, O or OO. Okay? So like kangaroo. Or something like that, okay? So fingers on buzzers, very quick. Here we go. Spiced pork sausage, famous for being mispronounced in kitchens and tapas bars all over Britain. Spanish, we're named for it.
Chorizo.
A very good point. I did not want the moo sound, but we had a moo sound.
It does kind of go with the word.
It does. Yeah. Okay. A cowboy. A cowboy in Spanish. Go on.
No, vaquero.
Vaquero.
You cut.
Okay, we're going to give you the point for vaquero. There are two other words to describe cowboy. Anybody?
John Wayne.
John Wayne is not right. David? Gaucho.
Llanero. Gaucho. Okay. Llanero. All right.
We were talking about Cuba earlier and Fidel Castro. He enjoyed smoking a lot. What's the main ingredient of a cigar?
Tobacco.
Very good point. Very hot chili pepper starting with H.
Jalapeno.
No. Habanero. Famous chili sauce.
Tabasco.
Tabasco, very good. The sound a cow makes. Oh, God, I didn't know that was on there. That's very good. Green pear-shaped fruit. Actually, a single-seeded berry.
Mango.
Avocado, very good. A supermarket chain aligned to Eroski.
Caprabo.
Very good. Who came up with these? Okay, bouncing Australian animal.
Kangaroo.
Very good. Super hot curry. Vindaloo. Very good.
Sorry about that.
What you say when you sneeze, Susie?
Hachu.
Very good. The next one. The next one. Quick, say something. The proximo. Very good. The devil.
Diablo.
Very good. Famous TV detective?
Clouseau.
Bergerac.
Clouseau. She can get a point.
Just 5 points.
Colombo. All right.
Just Clouseau. End in O.
Sounds like an O. It's not spelled like that.
Maybe in Sweden. Inspector Clouseau. Okay. Two more questions. Famous 80s and 90s band with singer Alison Moyet.
Yazoo,
very good. A search engine like Google?
Yahoo, no.
Very good, Yahoo, very good. Yeah. And the very last one, the stupid question, soapy stuff you wash your hair with?
Shampoo.
Very good, okay. Excellent, you've done very, very well. I don't know what the final score is.
Let's see.
It's another nail biter. Chris, I've failed you. John and Marcella / Chris, 31.5. Susie and David, 32.
Okay.
We won!
So
congratulations!
Okay, I'm just going to say that's the end of us. That's the end from us. That's all from us. From season one. That was the end of season one. 10 shows. We've done 10 weekly shows since May the 24th here on Radio Canal Barcelona, and it's time to take a break until the middle of September. I'd like to thank my guests today, John, Marcella, Susie and David, our third referee and original Swede, Viveka, and also our team captains that are normally with us, Xavi Castells and Chris Groves, who couldn't be with us today because they're actually doing TV tours and comedy tours.
Apparently. Allegedly.
I'd also like to thank Francis Wardley, who's sat in with us sometimes, and our great production team. Alex, give Alex a wave behind the screen.
Bravo!
Lola, a special mention to Katrina, people on the grid, and thanks to you all for listening. We're going to be back in middle of September, and it's been great fun. Thanks very much.
Thank you.